You talking to me?
Did you have a brain tumor for breakfast?
Then who the hell else are you talking to? Talking to me?
I'm funny how? I mean, funny like a clown.
I'm Peter Brinkman.
We all go a little mad sometimes.
Man that doesn't spend time in the stomach will never be a real man.
Yeah!
Hot. I'm kind of a big deal.
You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
Yo!
Yo!
Yeah, how you doing?
Yeah, I'm doing everything I can. How are you?
The same. I do everything I can possibly can, I do. Sometimes there's something I can't do. I just try and do it anyway.
For example,
walk on water.
I've tried it
because I saw it was like a magic thing over the Christmas period, and one of them walked on water. Actually, he didn't seem to have terribly large feet. I thought I can do that.
Yeah.
Turns out I can't.
No. Was it bathtub?
No. For the, you know, the river around the back of my house.
Yes.
So, because there's mainly rocks, and so
you thought you could just get away with it. Yeah,
I'll walk on the rocks, and then I'll just try into the water. And I just went in the water and got wet.
What are we doing today, Andy?
We are going to discuss the great Michael Keaton and his new film,
Birdman.
Yes.
Birdman.
Yes.
Or as the subtitle said, the unexpected virtue of ignorance.
Yeah.
How did we end up here? This place is horrible. Smells like balls. We had it all. You were a movie star, remember?
Who was this guy? He used to be Birdman.
I like that poster.
You wrote this adaptation?
I did, yeah.
And you're directing and starring in your adaptation. That's ambitious.
Are you afraid people will say you're doing this play to battle the impression that you're a washed-up comic strip character?
Absolutely not. That's why 20 years ago I said no to Birdman 4.
Hold the mask off!
Thank you, everybody.
You do hold the mask off!
Now you're about to destroy what's left of your career. We should have done that reality show they offered us.
Shut up.
Oh, ow! I'm gonna crab up on your ass, fucking choke you out.
Don't. You know I'm right.
You're so nice.
Hey, what's up? Why don't you try to rest a little bit?
Face it, Dad. You're doing this because you're scared to death, like the rest of us, that you don't matter. And you know what? You're right. You don't.
Baby, can you understand me now? Sometimes I get a little mad. Don't you know no one alive can always be an angel? When things go wrong, I seem to go bad.
Listen to me. I'm just a... You are the original man. Let's make a comeback. Oh, Lord, please, be. That's what I'm talking about. You're a bird man. Yeah. You are a god. Music.
He's a Hollywood clown in a lycra bird suit.
Yes, he is. But he's going out on that stage and risking everything.
It's about being respected and validated, remember? That's what you told me. That's how you got me into this shit.
I got a chance to do something right. I gotta take it. Let's go back one more time and show them what we're capable of.
Birdman!
There you go, you motherfucker.
Dude, you fucking rock!
My ass was a really good trailer.
Yeah. Well, what did it tell you? What did the trailer tell you before you actually started watching the film?
Washed up actor who's trying to make a comeback.
Yeah.
And it's probably going to be funny.
Hopefully.
Yeah, hopefully.
Yes. that nothing... Were you afraid that everything in the trailer that was funny was all there was? Did you have like...
I never consciously thought that, no.
No.
I kind of saw it... I saw Zach Galifianakis was in it. Zach Galifianakis is in it, and I thought, I like him.
He's
good. I always like Keaton, no matter what he's in. I've got a...
Edward Norton,
yeah. Did not find annoying in this film whatsoever.
Do you normally find him annoying?
Not normally. Of late, I have.
Ah.
Apart from the Grand Budapest Hotel, which is just fantastic, and everyone in that's brilliant.
Yeah, I think we'll touch upon Edward Norton. That's probably the wrong phrase.
I'm
going to
touch Edward Norton. Is he here? Right. What a surprise.
If you think about the role that he had in this movie, I think people would want to keep a bit of a distance from his throbbing appendage.
Well, only when he's on stage, though, he can't get it up.
So, Birdman is a black comedy. And it's a black comedy about a washed-up... Like you say, it's a washed-up actor who is trying to bring his career back to life through means of theatre. And that one big theatre gig. And it's almost as if he's hanging everything onto this one...
That's exactly what he's doing, isn't it?
Yeah, everything is just hanging on to this one production.
Mm. Michael Keaton's in it. Great.
We haven't seen him... this is the funny thing, because he said this in an interview, that he finds it strange that people think that they haven't seen him for a long time.
Funnily enough, yeah. I thought, I've not seen him for eight. Apart from when he turned up in like RoboCop. But he's worked consistently since, what, 70...
Exactly. Yeah. I think the difference is that he's done the work, but he hasn't tried to jump on top of anybody's performances, or he hasn't tried to kind of be anything beyond the role that he's been given. You know, he knows if he's got a supporting role, he's going to be supporting, you know, Jackie Brown, like you say, RoboCop. He is not RoboCop. He's not going to jump out and say, "Hi, here I am. You know, I'm Ken doll in Toy Story." He's not going to just... Yeah, he's just realizes that he doesn't need to be all over the production.
Mm. Yeah, going back to Toy Story. It's introducing Toy Story 2, isn't he?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. I remember thinking, who is that? I know that. All the way through, I had to wait for the credits and thought, oh, it's Keaton!
But
That's how Taylor said it. That's Keaton!
It's Keaton!
I was excited.
Oh, yeah.
I love him.
Do you know what? I just realised I was going to do my joke about me thinking it was Diane Keaton.
We can mix that in.
Nah, let's cut it out.
All right.
It's not even funny. What am I going to do, sit here wearing a pair of pants that go right up to my nipples? Am I just going to sit there, you know? Birdman is I think it was one of these film experiences that I did not expect to be so good.
That makes me happy to hear you say that.
Yeah, I didn't expect it to be this good, and I was surprised. I didn't know what to expect going in. I watched it with my wife, and she doesn't usually watch these kind of films.
Mm.
There's so much to touch upon about this film alone.
Because my expectations going into it was, I think this is going to be really good.
Yeah, you actually...
I thought this is going to be really good. I just had that feeling about the film. It way better than I thought it was going to be.
And it's impressive, isn't it, when you can actually get that experience.
Yeah, I mean, from performances...
Yeah.
I mean, the way it's filmed is technically incredible, astonishing.
Yeah.
I mean, the cuts are there, they're obvious.
Yes.
They're like night and day cuts, or they walk into a room and it goes dark for a second. You can see the cut, but then...
Yeah.
But at some points, it was like 30 minutes, there was no cut.
Yeah, yeah. It felt like it was... And the idea was is that they really, really wanted to have the whole film as like you're watching Broadway, like you are watching theatre.
Yeah, but it never feels like a theatre performance to watch.
It's still cinematic.
It still grabs
you. And the only other film that I can think of that was anywhere like that but didn't quite get the cinematic feel was Alfred Hitchcock's Rope.
Yeah, Rope, yeah.
And Rope really was just one stage leading into another room. But with this... They literally just put you right there in the middle of New York City. They put you right there, and you're literally just following them around. And you, if you really allow yourself, you can just get so deep into that film that you just don't, you know, you just don't know where you are. You're just lost in it, and it's that good.
Yeah, and it's gonna need repeat viewings because
yes,
you watch it and it's a film, like as we said, just about an actor who's on his ass basically, and he's trying to make his big comeback.
Yes.
Then it's a film that's about family, being a father. Then it's a film about celebrity.
Yeah.
Then it's a film about
rediscovery.
Yeah, so, rediscovery. Yeah.
Rediscovery.
Redemption.
Redemption. It's about relationships with people who are difficult to have relationships with, like the critic.
Yeah.
I mean, there's that beautiful line.
But that scene, I think, is with when he approaches the critic, I think is one of the most important scenes in the whole film.
It is, and it's about being real. It's about the thing is, this film is not afraid to be honest.
No, absolutely not. Another level of it, which we just need to talk about, is it's attacking the whole superhero film genre that's, you know, saturating blockbuster cinema now.
But there seems to be I've never seen so little bullshit in a movie in my life. I don't think where you actually feel as though that nothing is being contrived, nobody's setting people up, that they're not waiting for their line to be delivered. They're literally just living and breathing in this environment.
Exactly,
in this film.
And every character is so well drawn.
Yeah,
everyone gets the moment to shine. Just little like bit parts and little extras. It seems there's more to everything in it.
And that's a testament not just to the director, because I'm sure he had a say in who was going to be cast, but the casting people there as well. Whoever decides on getting these people in for the roles, and knowing in that one audition that person is the right person.
Yeah.
I can't see anybody else in these roles, and that's what is so amazing. I mean, even Zach Galifianakis. I mean, Zach Galifianakis is one of those people who I think he could be hit and miss at any moment, but he just honed in on that role, and he didn't try to do anything but that role.
Yeah, obviously he's doing what the director's telling him to do. He's not being all Zach Galifianakis,
but that's,
he's very understated in it.
Yes.
And he can act.
He can, and that's it. I mean, the whole idea, I think, of a great performance is not the fact that you can be brashy and jumpy and roll around like Beetlejuice of another Michael Keaton film, but to actually be non-responsive in a role is as important.
Mm.
It's the Dustin Hoffman graduate thing.
Yeah,
that the actual no response is often the best response for something to actually happen on screen. By delivering nothing and for something to actually happen from nothing, it's a really, really tough thing to do, to actually underplay a role. I think that's probably why I'm not an actor. Reason number 47.
You are an actor. Don't be.
But there are some incredible things in this film, and I think the first thing we just touched upon was the cutting, the different. Long scenes, the uncut. It's shot like theatre, and a lot of those scenes have the characters just walking and talking.
Yes.
And that is a risk. That is always a risk in movies, because recently, whenever we've seen films where there's a lot of walking and talking, there's a huge chance of getting bored and getting irritable about the fact that people are just walking and talking, but not here.
No, definitely not. And I think a lot of the time you'll be following, say, like Michael Keaton, and you know they're having a discussion, and then Naomi Watts will come down a corridor, and then you go and follow her for a little bit until you rejoin Michael Keaton on the stage.
Yes.
And that interplay we'll follow you. It's like,
it's so natural.
It's so natural. It's as if you're flying on the wall, just following them around. You know what? You're interesting. I'll go and follow you for a bit. Oh, who's this? I'll go over there, and the camera just follows, and it's. And how the lighting in this film is astonishing, because
how the hell did they do the light?
We've both acted on stage,
yes.
And you know how dark it is in the back of theatres and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
The lighting must have been, because you never lose any of the lighting, and it's all and it's constant, and it easily flows through the back of the stages, and incredible.
That's it, and they don't lose any detail. I mean, you know, and it is. I mean, that's like working in Ultra 4D. having the brain to be able to actually light in a 3D environment, knowing that at any moment the camera is going to turn, and for some cinematographers, turning a camera in a scene that's just been perfectly lit, is a whole lot of homework and a lot of work for them to have to work on, because you're then going to lose that lighting over there, and everything that all the lights that are actually coming down this way.
That's what it is.
It is exactly that. It is an astonishing effort.
Yeah, and it should be noted that the cinematographer was Emmanuel Lubezki.
Yes.
Who's the guy who did the massively overrated but technically great Gravity.
Yeah.
And
he also
did the cinematography for Children of Men, which is a
Okay.
You can see it. He's got a style of that long shots.
But lighting is probably, I think it's one of the hardest things, like we said. We sound is as difficult, but lighting is something that you can miss. You could spend more time doing lighting than you can actually do filming.
Oh, come on. We both know you can set up a 1 minute shot. It takes you about two hours to get the lighting right.
Do you remember in the car for CSU03 when we were simulating vehicles going past by using a light?
Yeah.
And unfortunately, I kept on putting my arm in front of the camera. So you could just see Andy sitting there in the passenger driver's seat, just touching his forehead, and all of a sudden this light comes towards him from the back in the shot. It's hard. It's tough. It's one of those things that really stood out.
And the dangers of shooting in this style is how long it took them to get it right.
Yeah.
One little thing goes wrong and you're right back to beginning, right, another half an hour shot that they've got to set up again, go the lighting right again, right, let's go.
But Zach Galifianakis said that was probably one of the hardest things he had to do, and there was a couple of times where he made a mistake on a line, but he was, luckily he's gotten to the point where he's so talented that he's able to cover the mistakes, and the mistakes are still in the film.
Wow.
And that's one of those things that, you know, if you're a really intuitive actor and you know you've made a mistake, but you're still in the character, you're able to kind of redirect that mistake and get it back on the path again.
And a testament to the actors to know he's made a mistake, but just go with it.
And usually Catherine would notice these things. If he forgot his line, or he repeated his line again. Was that a mistake? Sometimes we sit there and think that there's something not quite right. There's something not organic with that performance just then. It's like he just forgot who he was. But none of that happened with any of these actors.
Standout performances for you? Apart from all of them?
Apart from all of them?
It's worth noting that, you know, Keaton has just won a Golden Globe.
Yes, just last night.
Just last night, yeah. Emma Stone. I thought she was fantastic in it.
She was great, and she had a couple of great monologues, I think, that really pulled her out.
Yeah.
But
because her dad's saying, because she smokes a spliff, doesn't she?
Yeah.
And her dad's making it all about him, which he's an actor.
You.
It's all about him.
Yeah.
What are you doing to me, kind of thing? And that monologue she fires back at him is just fantastic.
It is. But what I kind of find with Emma Stone is that whenever actors are there doing their thing, she tends to kind of look like she's just watching the scene. There's a couple of times where I just kind of felt as though she wasn't always just... I kind of felt as though, I wanted her to kind of be more engaging when she wasn't saying anything. Yeah.
See, I didn't get that.
I
know what you mean.
Yeah,
and I registered it like that, but not. I just took that as she's vacant. She's just got out of rehab, and she's a little bit invested in herself and in her own head. And
maybe I'm ignorant of that.
Well, you've never been in rehab, have you?
No, I clearly haven't. No, but I'm very good at vacant staring. So maybe it's because I don't like that part about myself that I'm just picking on her.
That's interesting. Every time I talk, so that's how you look at me, just vacant.
Yeah, and maybe it's maybe I just have issues. Maybe this film is really just a big therapy book that just slams against your head and says, "Look, yeah, you pay attention to this because this is what you're doing. You're fucking up." but I maybe I was just being a bit harsh on Emma Stone there then. But yeah, standout performances. I can't really, you know, everybody just seems to just fit.
Yeah.
I don't think there's anybody I'd want to replace or
pull
definitely
out, not, no. You know? Absolutely not.
Michael Keaton noted, actually, that the actor at the beginning of the film who Edward Norton replaced because he got hit in the head with a lamp. Spoiler alert, by the way, guys.
Which is blackly comic. I laughed.
That was freaking amazing.
Because yeah, it's just so... He's a terrible actor, you know what I mean? And then this lamp's boom! The way it happens is so great.
Ironically, he says that the actor there was probably one of the most seasoned actors, theatrical actors of the entire ensemble cast.
Either
Michael Keaton's just trying to be ironic for the sake of saying that this guy left the film early, and we kind of totally respect him for that, for what he did. But yeah, I think it's kind of interesting that he said that he was probably the one of the most professional. And for him to actually play an actor who was playing bad was totally against, you know, his true nature.
That's a nice juxtaposition from a bad actor just being bad, and then a good actor acting bad.
Yeah, and that probably is just as hard. You know?
I would imagine so. Yeah.
I
find it really difficult to act bad.
Yeah, because yeah. No. But we ought to try that. Oh, we have tried that.
Yeah, we succeeded.
It's like, yeah, I know exactly what you mean. Oh, but. Yeah, but we're just not this film has fear, but it's not afraid. It's not afraid to have fear.
No, it's a very brave film.
And there's that whole thing about, you know, when you're writing a script, you write scenes and you're taught that you need to go in late and leave the scene early. Okay, and what's amazing about this film is that how about you never know if you've actually entered or if we actually left at all. That's what Birdman is. You don't know. You don't know when you've actually started the scene or when you've left it. You're simply just in this.
Yeah, and there's no sort of time. There's no relative time in there.
No.
You go, because at one stage you're sort of just, you're on Keaton and he's dressed in certain clothes. And then it follows someone else, and then the camera never—it doesn't seem to. The next thing you know, you're in the actual. It's part of the play.
Mm.
You're in the play, and he's in different clothes. Down, like, when did that happen? What's all that about?
Exactly. You don't know that you left the scene. You don't know that you've gone somewhere. You know you've gone somewhere, but you just don't know temporal. It messes with your head in terms of time.
Yeah. Because the best part where it does that. I think it was just on Keaton, and then it goes between some trees and some, you know, and next thing you're in bed with Edward Norton and Naomi Watts, and he's actually trying to have sex with her.
Yeah, and that was quite funny, the fact that we were tricked several times, thinking that, because there was a moment where he was just casually walking towards the stage and we saw the audience, and Catherine just sat there and went, he's just, what's he doing?
Yeah,
and then all of a sudden he just joins the scene on stage. She said, "I thought he was going to go and disrupt the play." She didn't realize he was actually in the play.
Yeah.
And it's like, "Well, I get it now. Yeah, sure." It's like, but then they do disrupt the play, and then they do start messing around with the presentation, and things start falling apart. And I love that. That was hilarious. A lot of those scenes on the stage, I think they would probably. Just as entertaining as
like when Edward Norton, when they do the first preview of it, he's drinking actual gin and then has like a breakdown on stage.
Love it. That
it's
was
fantastic.
Brilliant.
Really good.
Talking about, let's talk a little bit about Edward Norton, because I've just got a few things that I've noted that he's always exceptional, and he always seems to enjoy playing these characters that are split.
Yeah.
And he has a history of films where being a split character, it's his thing. It's definitely his thing. Like Eddie Murphy is to latex, Edward Norton is to different personalities.
Okay.
Yes, that's my wonderful reference. Because he's done so many films where he's played against himself, either in his mind or externally. I mean, the Primal Fear, he was schizophrenic.
Yeah.
In Fight Club, he had multiple personality disorder. in Death to Smoochie, he has a kind of a split between when he's playing Smoochie the mascot, and he's being the actor who plays Smoochie the mascot. You've got to see that movie. It's kind of an interesting, odd movie. But and then you've got The Incredible Hulk, where he is Bruce Banner and the Hulk.
American History X, when he was a neo-Nazi, and now no longer is.
And then he is, yeah. Well, definitely splits directly right down the middle. And then you've got Leaves of Grass, where he plays both brothers, and he literally has scenes of himself arguing. Aye. And he does it so convincingly. It's done so well. Right up until the point where he's actually holding himself dying in his arms, in his own arms. I've never known an actor playing with himself on the scenes, and that's,
I know you mean, moment. I know you mean.
But yeah, he's great with mirror work. He knows his mirror.
Yeah.
And of course, when I see him standing in front of a mirror in this film, I just kind of see that as an homage to his career.
Okay.
It's like little kind of nuggets of symbolism that are purely for the actors, and I think that mirror scene was all about that, the fact that that's what he is, that's the kind of actor he is.
Yeah.
Okay, I've got a question for you.
Okay.
Does Michael Keaton work with or without fear? He's been around. He's done a lot of movies.
I would say I think he has for this.
Yes.
You can see it.
Yeah.
He didn't in RoboCop.
No.
Which was last year. And I can't... Jackie Brown, most of his films, no fear. This one, yeah.
Since Batman, he had no fear, pretty much.
Yeah. And I just an interesting little line. He said, I've not played Birdman since 1993, which was his last Batman film.
Yeah. Yeah,
which had just a little line I picked up. I thought, well, that's interesting.
Oh, I never got that one, but yeah, I think everything was. It was very obvious that the voice of Birdman was the voice of Batman.
But modern Batman, you know,
which is odd because I thought it was. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, well, it's because I think when he played Batman back in the 90s,
yeah,
there wasn't a massive difference with his voice, was there, from when he was playing Bruce Banner and when he was playing Batman?
Bruce Wayne,
bloody hell.
I know, why they think about to be called Bruce, come on.
I'd be interested, because the pickup line, the have a little dig at Robert Downey Jr.
Yes,
that's true. One of the superheroes actors did he have a dig at? Michael Fassbender, because he said, I'll get Michael Fassbender.
Yeah?
Because it's sort of, they're having a dig at, like people who can act, are good actors who are now in these superhero films, have a little dig at. They don't have a dig at Edward Norton for being in Hulk, though. I noticed that.
That's true. That is very true.
So we'll let him off because he's in the film and he's really good.
Yeah. Well, has Emma Stone done anything?
She was in Spider-Man.
There you go. Yeah. So maybe that's probably a little bit of influence there for the casting.
Yeah.
That there has to be some sort of a link with superheroes in some way or indirectly.
So do you think the film in some ways is sort of angry at that, you know, whoever's made this film is sort of angry at so much superheroes and cinema now?
Okay, let me say this and be very serious and just open my bottle of water while I say this, because it kind of feels right. All comedy is serious. Every comedy, anything that is funny, every joke that is said in a film, whether it's black comedy, stupid comedy, there is always an element of truth. And I think that is exactly what you've just hit the nail on the head. That there is, it's telling Hollywood, you know, you've got a lot of. I mean, if you think about this film, or if you compare it to all the Transformers films and all the things that we get angry about recently, we've been saying it so much that Hollywood is losing its way, it doesn't have any fear, it's not making movies that really make you think, it's not making movies that are slow, that draw you in. This film is literally just telling everyone, yes, you can. Yes, you can. And maybe this is the front runner of a kind of a newly discovered Hollywood that's going to say, okay, Birdman was really successful. What did it do? It subverted the rules. It broke new grounds. It told everybody that they're being ridiculous about this whole superhero thing. And it, in a way, I mean, I know you're a fan of the Marvel and these films, but in a way, there are a heck of a lot of there's a lot of overexposure when it comes to superhero movies.
There is, and that's because that's what's been selling, that's what's been making the money. So that's all.
But is that all that we want?
That's not what we want, but that's what the people who own the studios want. They want to earn money. I'd say it's not about artistic.
But imagine,
which we've talked about quite a lot. You know?
But imagine if superhero movies weren't the thing, they would have found something else that would have been the big seller, and they would be pumping that.
Of course, yeah, like in the 80s, it was just action films, so that's what they pumped the money in then.
Exactly.
What was it in the 90s?
Dinosaurs.
Dinosaurs, yeah.
Godzilla, and... but yeah, I mean, this is...
That's what I love most, scene when he goes up to the critic, gives her a drink, and she basically just, you know, I want you to lose because I hate you. And why I think it's so important, that scene, is it polarises both...
Yeah,
both parts of that, because she's a sniffy critic who thinks you've just come from superhero films, therefore you're worthless and have no artistic credibility.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. And he's coming from the side of saying, "Well, no, don't judge me on that.
Yes,
I can't. So you
judge me on this performance,
on this,
alone. This
yeah,
right
exactly.
now,
yeah.
whatever's before."
She'd already decided it's rubbish because he's come from a background that she deems not worth. So you've got both sides there. You've got the side of saying, well, the sniffy critic who's talking about one set of people who won't watch superhero films because it's stupid.
Yes.
But then you've got people saying, well, no, don't judge it until you've seen it.
Yeah, that's exactly... That, I love that. Because that makes me think... I actually, when I saw that scene, and you were right about saying that it's probably one of the most important scenes in the film... They said something along the lines of, I think I actually wrote it down. Yes, when he says to her, "You risk nothing. This play cost me everything."
Yeah,
and of course there's foreshadowing there because it seems to be that there's that possibility that it did almost cost him his life.
Yeah,
but it kind of stopped me in my tracks, and I thought, should I actually be reviewing films? Should I be critical of? Should I be criticizing films?
Mm.
I mean, is there such thing as there being no bad movies? And am I stomping on? If we ever do find a bad movie, do we actually go too far as to say how much we hate it just because it's popular to do so? Is she, you know, is it? It seems to be.
Mm.
It's popular to put the dirty on actors who are now playing superhero films, even though they actually have done good things in the past.
Hmm.
It seems popular to break things that are, you know, to break older actors who are trying to play younger roles, that kind of thing. There's a lot of things that we are told already to be negative about, and I think that she's just encapsulated that whole thing with that one phrase there, "You risk nothing, this play cost me everything." We're not putting any risk involved in our reviews. We're not actually putting ourselves out there to better anything, but it's always easier to destroy, and it's always easier to kind of take the popular road and break things down.
Yeah, I think it's human nature to look at anything and say what's bad about it.
Yes.
It's very hard to look in and say, well, all right, let's find out what's good about that.
Yeah.
What is good about Dumb and Dumber 2?
There has to be. I mean, I'm sure that when we go on to other films in the near future,
very near future,
that we're probably going to be talking about, you know, old people who actually do put a movie together.
Mm.
I mean, there are people who made Dumb and Dumber 2 who are talented people. And yeah, I mean, again, the opposite could also be true. There could have been people working on Birdman who were just complete assholes. You never know. And but you know, it still gets things done.
I jury's out on whether Naomi Watts is a decent person. You know what I mean? I found she walked out of an interview with Simon Mayo.
Did she?
Yeah, he was asking her just about Diane, and she was like, right, we're being told to stop the interview now. No, thank you. and just stops it. And he, I think he had like about a minute left to work, talk with her and just left him.
Really?
Yeah.
No, that's just disappointing.
I think it's because she knew she'd made an awful film, but...
Yeah, but so, you know, everybody makes those kind of films. It's not...
But what's good about Diane?
But what's good about Diane? Well, yeah. I mean, it's always questionable when bad films are made, why these films are actually made. And we kind of... It's a mind-boggling situation because we ourselves want to make film. We ourselves want to sell our ideas. We think we firmly believe and love the things that we've written, and we'd love to see them on the big screen. And we're kind of like we kind of feel it does feel.
We discussed
raging.
This before, yeah. But say you've got a person who's trying to make something good, and it doesn't turn out to be good, and then put that against Michael Bay, who's just putting awful. Sexist stuff out because that's what he is at the core, and he's not bothered about making anything good.
Yeah,
he's just bothered about making money and advertising.
Yeah,
so it's okay to because I'll bring this back to Birdman because why was he making it?
Yeah,
it's ambivalent, it's ambiguous. Sorry, because is he making it because he wants to do something artistically great, or is he only doing it to get his name back out there?
Yes.
Which one of them is it? Because you don't know.
You don't know, yeah, you're right.
Is he a nice person who's just really desperately trying to do something?
Or is
he
it
just,
personal?
Is it personal? Does he just want to be back in the limelight again?
Yeah. And okay, so I think we've really, really hit home on a lot of points there, and there's a lot of things that we can't answer because it is such a subjective movie, and I think there's so many things in this film that we don't know for sure because it's left ambiguous.
Yeah.
And that's the best kind of film. We've already said that. And then,
absolutely.
When you've got things that are answered constantly, you didn't have any characters standing there saying, "Well, he's doing this because of this and that, and because of that." Mm. Thank goodness.
Yeah.
But there is one element of this film that is the biggest question on everybody's lips: is Birdman real? Is Michael Keaton imagining that he has telekinesis powers?
The opening shot is perfect. Where he just fades in, and he's just like hovering, isn't
hovering,
he?
Yeah.
That's brilliant.
It's fantastic, and it's like balls. That's the first word that I heard because I you go in and you're kind of looking at things,
yeah.
And I didn't pay attention until he said balls.
Yeah,
that's
interesting because that first shot, I was fascinated. I was looking around the room and
looking at all
the things that were going on, as if I was just there.
Yeah,
that's the feeling. You're just going around watching this.
Yeah, and that's it. You are a fly already. You're it's like you've just come out of your cocoon and you've got your first chance to fly for the first time.
I'm Jeff Goldblum.
We're Birdman. Maybe we are Birdman. Maybe the viewer sitting here is the Birdman of the situation of that film.
Yeah,
and that's the whole point. That's why we're always gliding behind him. I mean, when we actually do see Birdman, he is
just
gliding
behind him.
So there's that kind of audience participation feeling that you are, you know, you really want to believe that there is a Birdman in this film as much as he does. But the fact that there's the scenes where we think that he's flying and then all of a sudden he lands, goes into the theatre and then
the taxi cab
chases him.
You're not paying me.
I can't believe how ingenious that is.
So good
because you don't know what to believe,
and a part of you wants to believe that he has got this telekinesis.
I kept on saying that as things in cabin because when he jumps off I said no don't worry he is Birdman. I'm surprised I didn't get thrown out of the theatre.
That's such a beautiful scene. That's a beautiful moment where he just drops off and then he just goes flying around the city. It's beautiful.
Yeah. And you don't care that he's dangling in a green screen environment to do it. You know, you don't care that, you know, because you are totally sold that this is, you're in his mind and you're just going for it, you know.
Yeah. Because that's when he's just basically he's embraced that he's Birdman, hasn't he? Because up to that point, when this voice starts, he's arguing, shut up, all the time.
Resisting.
Yeah, and it's when he's like got himself drunk and he's fallen asleep on the street, hasn't he? He wakes up and he's just walking and Birdman's talking to him, you know, saying...
It's when he's most vulnerable,
Let's make another Birdman. We'll make a billion by the next year, you know, and then he just embraces it. All that with the massive sort of bird and all.
That's just his mind going wild.
Yeah, no, it looks amazing.
It's great, isn't it?
And then when he's embraced it, he's happy, isn't he? And then he just goes flying off into the sea.
I've never seen so much happiness from a character. It's freedom. It's like a freeing feeling, and it's
And you get that when you accept something about yourself. It's enlightening. And
yeah, there's a few interpretations about that last scene as well. I mean, spoilers again. I mean, I hate having to say spoilers, but you know, there's bound to be somebody watching this who hasn't seen the film. If you haven't seen the film, then just stop this. I mean, we're analysing the movie. What do you expect? You're on the internet. What do you think we're going to be talking about but the whole movie? So, it's implied.
So you talk about the end?
Yeah, let's talk about the end. Dying, is it a dying... is it a dying dream? Did he actually shoot himself? Or what was it actually... Did he shoot his nose off? What's real? What it actually took place?
I think he did. I think he shot his nose off.
Okay.
I do. Whether he intended to actually kill himself and then just blow his own nose off.
Yeah.
Because, yeah... I liked it, and I liked the when Zach Galifianakis was like, you know, it's okay, he's got a new nose. If he doesn't like him, we'll get him another one. That's so Hollywood and so brilliant.
Exactly, and that is another knock on the Hollywood door and saying, hey, you guys.
We're watching you. We know what you're up to. You know what I mean?
We're not pretending here. This is it. And I really,
you know what we've discussed when we talked about Twin Peaks?
Yeah,
that's one of the rare films where when it's finished, I couldn't speak, and yes. It was that Pan's Labyrinth. This film did it.
Yeah,
that I know you're going to want to talk about your different theories in a set, but that when she just, you know, he basically goes out the window, doesn't he?
Yeah.
And then does he drop to his death? We don't know.
No.
And then his daughter, played by Emma Stone, just walks out, looks down, and she can't see it. She basically notices that he's missing out the hotel room. The window's open. She goes over to the window and looks down.
Yeah.
She looks around shocked, looks up, and just smiles.
Yeah.
Like she's seen something beautiful, and then it ends. Oh my God!
And is it evangelical? That's what I was.
Thinking. Yeah, that's what I went. It's a spiritual moment. That's such an iconic look, because even her arms are sort of open and she looked up and just smiled.
Yeah.
As if looking at something.
And for
majestic.
two people who are kind of like on the bench when it comes to religious, but we totally appreciate spiritualism. We totally appreciate the spiritual feeling of, because I just thought angels. I just thought wings of desire. He's just literally just going.
Yeah.
But he's not coming back.
No.
I don't get that he's coming back from that. It's not a... Because he's come back already. He's already jumped off a building. Or did he? Or was he wrestled off the top of that building and put into... And you know, did he just not... Was he never on top of the building?
Yeah, was he even
with?
Ever there? Yeah.
Was he ever living there? I mean,
did he just get into a taxi? And,
yeah. So it is amazing. And I'm just glad that Edward Norton didn't say, you know, he's actually in his head and he's Tyler Durden or something crazy like that. I'm glad they didn't spin it too far. They kept it straight. It was Birdman all along, and it's all, you know, it's all there.
And like just masterful filmmaking. It doesn't answer the questions. We could watch this film 1,000 times and take it 1,000 different ways.
Yeah, and I can't wait to watch it again in a way, because it always depends on your mood as well. I mean, when I watch Pan's Labyrinth or The Fountain, I don't know if you've ever seen.
Oh, sorry, I love The Fountain.
Yeah, that are films that really make you think and you go back to because you want. It's almost as if you're going back for another hit of something, or you want to learn something else.
Mm.
You know that there are more layers there for you. Like Taxi Driver. Every time I watch Taxi Driver, I find something else to feel.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's
That's the same with like Mulholland Drive and films like that.
Yeah.
Which again, it's a good. It's a good parallel to make, because Mulholland Drive is primarily all about Hollywood.
It's also a black comedy.
Yeah,
there's some hilarious moments in that.
When he comes in and he finds his wife in bed with the pool cleaner.
All of that.
And that's hilarious. The way the pool cleaner's, look, man. Welcome to start talking about Mulholland Drive. And I'm like, look, man.
Tangent,
we're all adults
one.
Here.
Tangent number one.
We're all adults here. Come on, man. Just calm down. It's brilliant. Really funny.
yeah, Mulholland Drive, the one thing that got me was the, when that killer is trying to kill that person in the office, and he gets walked in on by somebody else. So he shows, tries to kill her and shoots through the wall and shoots somebody else.
Yeah, that's brilliant.
It's just like, wow, that's just, that's mind-boggling. Okay, so...
Is there anything else you want to say about the end?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. I kind of wanted to just feel it out. But like you say, it is ambiguous.
It is.
We could talk about all the different routes, different possibilities, but it kind of spoils it yourself because it's a person. It seems like it's a personal,
yeah,
understanding. You take what you need to take.
You do, much like you. I watched it with my wife, and she likes like any kind of film, but mainly we watch horror films together. She's a big, and I was thinking with this, it's going to be a bit of a. I'm not sure she's going to really enjoy this as much. I've tried to get her to watch David Lynch films, and she's not really into that kind of, you know, she wants to watch something, just enjoy it.
You're right.
And she was just knocked out by it.
And that's great, because it makes you realize, you know, well, there are still films out there that can do that.
Yeah, because
just want to just be entertained.
I can have that effect watching Mulholland Drive, but she wouldn't. She'd watch it and go, yeah, that's not for me. But this film worked on her.
Great.
That's to me is
powerful.
Yeah, that's powerful. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so it's normally like a 1 in 10 people in a room kind of a situation, but curious, what about River? How was she? Did she enjoy it?
Oh yeah, River loved. She especially liked all the swearing.
And the
like
nudity.
5-year-old daughter. Yeah.
Yes.
When she saw two girls kiss, she was like, "Well, I actually made her watch that. But I want her to be grow up to be a lesbian."
It's not going to stay in the podcast.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. No fear. Okay. Well, like we said, no fear. We need to be a little bit more good. No.
I don't mind, honestly. That's fine.
Okay, so the one last point that I want to make about the Birdman is
a 2-hour-long drum solo.
Ooh, yeah. Well,
let's talk about the music first.
I love the music.
It was fantastic. The sort of jazz drum solo all the way through.
I wouldn't buy the soundtrack though.
No,
I said this to Catherine. I think it was Catherine who said that. I said it works for the movie.
Oh, yeah,
but you can't separate the soundtrack unless you actually intend to play along with it, then you might be able to do a bit of jamming. But yeah, for the movie it's
really good. It works really well, and that's another thing that makes it exciting when they're walking through the corridors and talking.
Yeah,
this sort of very energetic drum solo, jazz drum solo going in the background. I love the part when he's with Edward Norton, they walk to the streets and he just walks past the
actual drummer
and doing the solo, and then he
again,
brilliant.
And again, when
what's
Michael Keaton was running
what
around,
real?
When he's running around the stage, I mean, it's hilarious when he's actually running around in his underwear.
Oh, that's
and actually
amazing!
Goes down the
yeah,
with his hand as a gun. But there's that whole marching band that is the score.
Yeah,
I've never ever seen a film where the music is a character, is actually a part of something more. I mean, yeah, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, I thought that the jazz worked really well with the foley and the actual sound design of the film, but this one, it just took it to a whole new level.
It did. Apart from Spiceworld the Movie, the music sort of part as a character in Spiceworld the Movie.
It is, because it's the Spice Girls and they are the music.
Exactly.
They are music. They represent music in all of us.
It's really stood the test of time, that film.
Yeah, of course Guardians of the Galaxy used music quite appropriately.
It did, very much so, but like you said, I've never seen music done to such a great effect like this, apart from Spice World
apart from Spice World the movie. There you go, there's your Spice World bit.
I did it,
yay. Have you had your 5% of glory yet?
Oh, it's coming.
Have we had it yet?
I don't know.
I'm not sure. I think we've had a few.
Yeah, there's been a few moments, hasn't there?
But I think Birdman makes it easy to review. It's one of those films that, you know, it really brings it out of you. I mean, there's so much that we could talk about Birdemic, but we would never be able to be as eloquent or as forgiving of the actual outcome of the actual film. But there's been a lot of Bird films. Birdemic, Birdman.
That's it. Done it again. Birdemic.
There's so many films with birds in the title. Birdman.
Birdland. The Charlie Parker film.
Yeah.
Saxophonist.
There was an interesting thing that Michael Keaton said in an interview that he, even though we feel as though that this part was made for him, this part was literally just written for him. Perfect. It fitted his skin.
Yeah,
it literally.
Yeah.
But he said that he related to this character the least out of all the roles that he's had. He didn't relate to him in that personal way, but he understood him. It's a
I see
kind
that
of thing.
Because that's not. He's never been that guy, has he?
No,
so
he's
I
never been
say,
that
oh, conceited. Yeah,
no.
So you can never relate to that. Cause Michael Keaton as a person, he always seems like a really genuine, nice guy.
But yeah, and I kind of see that what we've done as an audience, like we said at the very beginning, and this is kind of going just kind of do a big circle as from how we started. We said when we saw Birdman, I haven't seen Michael Keaton in such a long time. And then we kind of like feel as though that we believe that this role relates to him more than it relates to him. That it relates to us.
Yeah.
So let me just try that again. 1 second. It'll be better the second time, I promise you.
Right, okay.
We've got it in our heads that Birdman is exactly what Keaton is experiencing at this time in his career. We've kind of made that reality ourselves, and that's why it's become such a popular question to ask him, you know, do you feel as though that this is representative of your current situation in your career? Because that's what we feel. That's our experience of Michael Keaton, because we feel as though we haven't seen him for such a long time, that we don't feel as though that he was ever as great as he was when he did Batman, Beetlejuice, and we miss that point. We forget that they're human beings, that he's probably got so many other things going on in his life that it doesn't matter. He doesn't need to be Michael Keaton, the guy who's in every single interview, who needs to be on cereal boxes. He doesn't need to sell things on the television. He doesn't need to be there in your pocket like some other actors feel as though they have to.
Yeah, yeah.
I could name many.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to. Because I know I'll only just get one.
Go on, no, name many.
I'm going to name many actors who just... Johnny Depp doesn't want to leave your side. He's always wants to be in every moment of your life.
There it is. One.
George Clooney. Brad Pitt. Angelina Jolie. People who you know, Amy Adams in a way.
Yeah.
Tom Cruise always wants to feel as though makes you feel his presence.
Like Darth Vader.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, but then you've got actors who just want to do the job and don't want to actually be caught up in the hype of Hollywood. And that's what he does. That's his life. And it's personal. He's living a life like everybody else.
I know the director wanted him for this. He did want him for that part. Yeah. Not because of anything, any relation to his life, but he's really good at traversing the comedic and the drama at the same time.
Yeah. So he's looking at it more on a technical standpoint of what the ability of the actor can bring to a project.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And I can believe that.
Mm.
But isn't it funny how...
I like Clooney, though. I like Clooney.
I do. And
oh, really?
I don't. I didn't mean to
oh, no,
besmirch.
You're not disparaging anybody. I'm just saying, yeah.
But they do... They're constantly there. Wherever you look, they're advertising things. They're being a part of Hollywood. You know, Leonardo DiCaprio, always just there being a part of Hollywood. And yet...
I know, I can't see Clooney's face without wanting to drink coffee anymore.
Do-do-do-do-do. Or to chat up beautiful women who are actually already, you know, with somebody else.
But then his humanitarian work is very prolific, so I give him a lot of respect. Clooney is very hands-on with it.
Yeah. Which
very
is different.
Hands-on.
Yeah.
He's an ambassador for, you know...
Yeah, and same with Michael Keaton. Yeah. I don't feel as though he's... I mean,
who incidentally changed his name from Michael Douglas to Michael Keaton because he didn't want to get confused with the other Michael Douglas.
And why Keaton? Because of his love of Buster Keaton, the comedy...
Was that what it was?
Yeah, he was such a huge fan of Buster Keaton as growing up, and I think he just adopted that because he wanted... to begin with, he wanted to be a comedy actor. He wanted to be a comedian, stand-up, and to be funny. He's very comfortable with that. He's very comfortable with letting himself go.
It's funny you mention that. So that's why Mel C changed the name out of Spiceworld the Movie. Because she wanted to be Mel Keaton. but she's not very good with the alphabet, so she put Mel C, which should be Mel K. And that's where she got. But apart from that, you know, because she likes, you know, Buster Keaton.
Because of her wonderful ability to bring comedy to any good situation.
Or, exactly.
Or song. But yeah, I wanted to get off the point quickly because another actor who actually we believed had disappeared from the world and then came back with a role that was kind of looked like it was written for him, Mickey Rourke and The Wrestler.
Yeah.
I see a lot of parallels in the way that we view Keaton's comeback. I'm doing air quotes. Air quotes. I'm sorry, yeah. It's not a comeback because he's never gone away. But then the same went for Mickey Rourke. I mean, if you look at his filmography, he was still making films even when he was going through his rough patch. Mm. But he was also doing other things where people were very aware that he was doing other things, but everybody thinks they just disappear off the planet, you know?
Mm.
But The Wrestler was very much written for him to have a comeback. And it's not a shame to say it.
Is that right?
Yeah, it's not a shame to say that this film brought me back to where I wanted to be.
The thing with Mickey Rourke, he's got that face now.
Yes.
So he's limited in what he can do.
Unfortunately, yeah, it's kind of like the Ron Perlman thing. I mean, I'm not picking up on any particular kind of thing, but the guy from Ghost as well. I mean, strong features.
Yeah.
Strong features are always a kind of a disservice because you always feel as though they're going to be pigeonholed for specific roles.
Yeah. Going back to Michael Keaton, he's just got like an everyday guy kind of quality to him.
It's the eyebrows. He's got the most specific to him eyebrows that I've ever known eyebrows to be specific to. Including Mel C. Spiceworld the Movie.
Her eyebrows are amazing.
Yeah, the best part of shit, man. I'm definitely going to get the DVD. And I want there to be a commentary. I have a demanding for that. But even though it probably doesn't need to. It's the film itself is just enough.
I'd like a commentary if they're just talking about
how they made it
like that. I don't want anyone to start explaining what symbolism in it that means this, and we want this.
I don't want that. We just want to know how to make the film. That's why I have the panic room. That's why I love David Fincher, because he never does that. He never pontificates about how wonderful his crew are, and he doesn't like to just tell everybody what he's really intending.
Mm.
He just tells you how he made the film. That'll be good.
That's a proper filmmaker. Yeah.
Last question.
Go on.
How would this film have been if Michael Bay directed it?
It would have been a Birdman. Aliens come from the Sirius system to overtake our planet for its celery growth. And a superhero called Birdman is humanity's last chance to save our celery and ourselves.
Played by Keaton?
No, it'll be played by Mark Wahlberg, probably.
Yeah.
Will Smith will be in it as the lovable sidekick. And there'll be lots of explosions. You wouldn't be able to see much. The Naomi Watts kiss, that'd still be in it, but it'd be a full-blown sex scene.
And there'll be lots of
lever whips, and then there'll be underage sex. The end.
Great, and a pumping soundtrack.
Yeah.
R. Kelly.
Yeah, no, Will Smith would do a song for it.
He'd do a song.
Yeah. Yo, Birdman coming at ya. Yo, Birdman.
Are you real? You don't know.
No, we would know, because Michael Bay made the film. We know exactly.
No ambiguity. But would the character still be an actor? But it would be right at the beginning of the film and it would just get taken out of the theatre and that would be it.
Yeah, he's an actor. That's his thing, he's an actor.
Yeah.
But in theatres. But secretly, he's Birdman.
Yes.
But he's never shown his superhero to humanity, because he's never felt he had to. But now, these aliens are attacking. He needs to bring out the Birdman.
And I think John Cusack should be one of the aliens.
Yeah, John Cusack. Yeah.
And John Cusack as well.
Both of them. Both of them.
Conjoined.
In fact, no, not aliens. The Cusacks are taking over the world. And it's up to Mark Wahlberg's Birdman to save us.
I like the script. I want to write this. It is great. Oh my god. Yeah, okay.
Are you going for that?
Yep, I'm going to go and get the typewriter out, okay?
Excellent, let's
do
this.
Whoa!
You know, I want to take this opportunity to let the people know how they can contact our friends of Frame by Frame. They do that podcast
thing. You know, those two guys, yeah, they do the podcast, okay? So
yeah,
how?
They're nice, they're like a forest, which is a beautiful thing.
Exactly. And so if you want to do the communicating thing, you know, the social networking thing.
Yeah, you can you can tweet those guys at Frame by Frame 78. If you'd like to go to their website, that will be www.roastedportions.com.
You don't need to do the www. It's implied that it's going to be the World Wide Web.
But people need to know that.
Okay, just go to roastedportions.com, okay? You go down on the right-hand side. You've got the social connections. You can talk to the people who do the show. You can even talk to the people who made that movie, you know, CACO3.
Who'd want to talk to those mooks?
I don't know. They made a pretty interesting movie, right?
Well,
it was in black and white.
Yeah, black and white.
We like black and white. Because, and there was also some trees in that movie, too.
Oh, trees. It's like being in a forest, which is a beautiful thing.
Other connections, you can really get to know these people on YouTube as well, and if you want to comment on their podcast, I urge you to do that, okay?
Yeah, I think it is a proper, really nice thing if people want to start contacting these guys.
Subscribe to them and comment. I mean, it's just polite, you know.
Also, you can email them at framebyframe78@gmail.com.
That's it. I think that's everything wrapped up, so...
Hey, I'm gonna go and plant a tree somewhere.
Okay, you go plant some trees.
I'm gonna go plant a tree.
I'm gonna go tweet.
You tweet, I'll plant a tree.
It's us, we're out of here.